earlier this week. National Security correspondent Jennifer Griffin is at the Pentagon tonight to tell us what that might mean.
When President Trump asks for military options in North Korea, this unit of U-1 bombers could be called on. They carry the largest conventional payload in the U.S. Air Force and fly almost weekly over the Korean Peninsula.
That's some pretty severe things that we're thinking about. That doesn't mean we're going to do them. I don't draw red lines.
In the wake of North Korea's intercontinental ballistic missile test on July 4th, Defense Secretary Jim Mattis, talking off-camera to reporters at the Pentagon today, downplayed any talk of war.
I do not believe this capability in itself for this close to war, because the President has been very clear, Secretary of State has been very clear, that we are leading with diplomatic and economic efforts.
So what are the President's military options?
There is evidently an underground facility, now being built for an operation to develop uranium for weapons. This is a centrifuge facility. It's possible you could use for U.S. penetrators to destroy that.
North Korea has an estimated 10 plutonium-based nuclear warheads, but it's the thousands of artillery units trained on the 10 million civilians living in Seoul that stymies talk of military action.
There's no credible way that you can
mobilize
quickly.
Weapons
that are within range of Seoul.
8시?
Basically, a lot of them are in very...
내일 아침에 8시. 그래.
8시. 알았어요.
예스.
어미모. 싸방 끝났어요? 빨리 주세요.
That number will increase to 44 by the end of this year.
We have enough interceptors to defeat the threat and another missiles from North Korea.
In December, the Pentagon put Special Operations Command in charge of countering weapons of mass destruction.
I'm like my little Pentagon darling.
Ranger and Delta Force teams will be tasked with coming up with plans for how to deal with North Korea's nukes.
Jennifer Griffin live at the State, at the Pentagon. Jennifer, thank you. Senior State Department officials now say the Persian Gulf crisis between Qatar and its Arab neighbors may not be over anytime soon.
May not be over any
supporting terrorist groups and extremists throughout that region. Correspondent Rich Edson has the latest tonight from the State Department.
Qatar has rejected the demands of its four Arab neighbors, and the standoff there continues.
Reading between the lines, the blockading countries were demanding that we must surrender our sovereignty as the price for ending the siege. Something they knew Qatar would never do.
Rejection of their terms, the four Arab nations announced no new sanctions against Qatar, even though it's, quote,
it's not going to end it anytime soon. What?
Extremism and terrorism and the consequent threats to the security of the region. Qatar denies it supports terrorism and says its Arab adversaries label their political opponents as terrorists to silence them. The United States says Qatar has improved in fighting terrorist financing, though it must continue addressing the problem. President Trump has sided with Saudi Arabia and its allies against Qatar, while Secretary of State Rex Tillerson has taken a more measured approach, trying to broker an agreement to end the dispute. The State Department acknowledges this crisis could take much longer to resolve.
It could drag on for months. It could possibly even intensify. The Secretary will remain engaged. He's been very engaged and has made himself available to all sides of this matter. We continue to stay in close contact with all of them and will continue to do so.
The State Department official says Secretary Tillerson will continue discussions with the feuding allies as he travels through Europe this week and next. The official says the secretary spoke yesterday with Saudi Arabia's new crown prince. Qatar says it is persisting through the blockade. Its ally Turkey is shipping goods as Saudi Arabia has closed Qatar's only land border. Kuwait also continues to try to broker an end to this conflict. As both sides remain defiant, the four nations that are opposing Qatar in this say they will meet again in Bahrain, but they have announced no date.
Rich Edson at State Department. Rich, thank you. Let's talk more about the Middle East, the Far East, and hotspots around the world. British Defense Minister Michael Fallon joins us here on set tonight. Mr. Minister, thanks for being here.
Pleasure.
Let's start with North Korea. Your sense of
Omimos un ninguno, ¿eh?
Well, I'll be reviewing that with Secretary Mattis at the Pentagon tomorrow, but it's clear what North Korea has done is illegal, it's provocative, and it's absolutely unacceptable. And it's not just the United States problem, this is a global problem. This North Korea is a threat to everybody, and we have to find a way through that. And I think that, first of all, means much more intensive diplomatic work. The international community has got to raise its game now, toughen the sanctions that already exist, introduce new sanctions, and to put pressure on Beijing, on China, to resolve this.
If push came to shove and that diplomatic effort didn't work, would Great Britain join the U.S. in some sort of military action?
Well, I think it's talking about military options. I understand why the United States wants to review those, but that's premature at the moment. The first thing is to get the international community to respond much more closely now, and to look at there have been 6 or 7 resolutions of the United Nations before. They haven't had the impact that we need, so we probably need a fresh resolution. Our people are working on that in New York, and we then need to enforce the existing sanctions. It isn't possible for North Korea to put together this program without accessing components, without accessing finance. So there have been clearly been some breaches of these sanctions, and we need to look at that.
Let's turn to the Middle East and Syria. Here is Secretary of State Tillerson today on possibly working with Russia on Syria.
We have been engaged with Russia for some time now to identify areas that we should have mutual interests. And I would say at this point, it's difficult to say
exactly.
Before this big meeting we've been talking about with President Putin, Secretary Tillerson mentioned working with Russia potentially on a no-fly zone in Syria. Is that a good idea?
Well, we've looked at no-fly zones before across the coalition. They're only worth suggesting if they can really be enforced. And the problem at the moment is it's difficult to see how they'd be enforced. And that's, if they're not enforceable, then they're a false comfort. It is important, of course, to keep Russia involved in this. Russia has enormous influence over the regime. Russia is the one country that could bring this civil war in Syria to end the suffering after so long. And it's important we try and keep Russia into this process.
What do you think, if you were advising President Trump in this meeting with President Putin, what would you tell him? How do you deal with Putin?
Well, you deal with him, I think, in a very clear-eyed way. You engage with him, but you be wary. And that means there are areas of the world where Russia has great influence. Syria is one of them. But you also got to be very clear that what Russia has been doing
is dynamic with Russia and energy in that region.
I think the president is quite right to call attention to the need for Europe to reduce its dependence on a single source of energy. A lot of these East European countries are totally dependent or substantially dependent on Russian gas. What's important is to diversify energy. In Britain, we are taking now and starting to take shale gas from the United States, but we also have nuclear, we also have renewables, solar and wind as well. It's important Europe diversifies so that it's no longer subject to any kind of political pressure. The president's right about that.
President Trump in Poland on NATO. The United States has demonstrated, not merely with words, but with its actions, that we stand firmly behind Article 5, the mutual defense commitment. Europe must do more. Europe must demonstrate that it believes in its future by investing its money to secure that future. Agree with that? What has President Trump's effect been on NATO?
Well, first of all, he's right about 2%. We're all committed to that. We've always met 2%. We continue to meet 2%. We're one of half a dozen countries now that meet 2%.
You too.
But since he urged Europe to do more, over 20 members of the alliance, there are 29 altogether, have started to increase their defense spending. So he's had a good effect on that. And it was very reassuring to hear him today talk about the Article 5 collective commitment that an attack on one member NATO is an attack on us all.
And you wanted to hear that from his...
We wanted to hear that. We had his commitment to NATO when our Prime Minister visited Washington 5-6 months ago. We've had that. But it was good, I think, particularly for the East European countries, to hear that directly from them, that America absolutely supports the principle of collective self-defense.
Last thing, last week in Brussels, you said that Great Britain would deploy 100 more troops to Afghanistan, but only in a non-combat role. Secretary Mattis, commanders at the Pentagon, say they need a few thousand, at least. The Pentagon's considering sending 4,000 more.
And Iraq is that these battles in the end have to be won by local forces that have the trust and confidence of the local population. Now we can help.
Cute bell.
We can help from the air.
Any time, Tapka.
It is from the Afghan.
Yeah. 我们잠깐조용히봐줘. Mother, I'm on the phone. 뒤만 I'm busy. 하지 않으면
I'm
coming. What
the fuck? Liberty Mutual stood with us when a fire destroyed the Liberty. We were able to replace everything in it.
Liberty did what?
Liberty, I don't care! He's angry. Yeah, I want to talk to my mother.
Yeah,
all right. I'm semi role play with you. Coward, not like Star Wars. You might want to.
There goes my boat. You can leave worry behind, but Liberty stands with you. Liberty stands with you. Liberty Mutual Insurance.
And while we make more e-commerce deliveries to homes than anyone else in the country, we never forget that your business is our business. The United States Postal Service, priority you. I wanted to know where my family came from. I did my ancestry DNA. The most shocking result was that I'm 26% Native American. I had no idea. It's opened up a whole new world for me.
Floodlight prevent crime? Ours does. Introducing Floodlight Cam by Ring. Security in a whole new light.
I'm really into this car. I don't know if I'm getting a good deal. I tell True Car by Zip which car I want, and True Car shows the range of prices people in my area actually pay for the same car, so I know if I'm getting a great price. This is how car buying was always meant to be. This is True Car.
Been turned down for a mortgage because of credit or tax return issues, CashCon Mortgage now has credit and income solving mortgages with no closing costs.
Mary and Shirley both need oxygen. Shirley lost her freedom the day she went on oxygen, but Mary has the brand new ultra compact Inogen 1 G4 oxygen concentrator from Inogen. It's the smallest and lightest model we've ever made. Shirley's forced to miss out on everyday activities. Mary fully enjoys her life. Shirley has to wait for tank deliveries and worries about running out of oxygen. But Mary's Inogen 1 G4 makes its own oxygen, so she'll always have the oxygen she needs anytime, anywhere. Shirley finally listened to Mary, and now has more freedom too. It's time for you to reclaim your freedom and independence with the Inogen 1 G4. Act now to start your 30-day risk-free trial. This is a limited-time offer, so don't wait and don't accept substitutions. The sooner you call, the sooner you can say goodbye to heavy oxygen tanks for good. And reclaim the freedom and independence you deserve. Call him out.
He was a blistering attack on the integrity of his predecessor and on the performance of the intelligence agency's first sitting president to drag partisan politics beyond the water's edge.
At times, President Trump's diplomacy looked a lot like that of other post-war presidents. At other times, however, as in his news conference with the Polish president, addressed Trump employed his singular slashing style.
They say he choked. Well, I don't think he choked. I think what happened was he thought Hillary Clinton was going to win the election, and he said, let's not do anything about it. Had he thought the other way, he would have done something about it. I remember when I was sitting back, how everybody was 100% sure that Iraq had weapons of mass destruction. And guess what? That led to one big mess.
Peace and appeasement are not on speaking terms.
It was at the dawn of the Cold War that a prominent senator pleaded for Americans to unite our official voice at the water's edge, so that America speaks with maximum authority. If you're just waking up, tweeted MSNBC's Joe Scarborough, one of President Trump's mainstream media critics at 6:50 a.m., the president of
World Affairs for our sole just possibilities of our being.
Indeed, the practice of criticizing opponents while on foreign soil has grown.